When Trafalgar Square was excavated, the river gravels there were found to be stuffed with bones, principally hippopotamus bones. Hippopotamus amphibious, the same species which lives in Africa today, was common in all the wet areas of Europe, again in a similar climate to our own. There are also rhino bones and elephant bones there, and the remains of hyenas and lions. Yes, there were lions in Trafalgar Square long before Edwin Landseer got to work. This was all part of the global megafauna. Every continent on Earth had a megafauna. Megafaunas were universal. The distribution of megafaunas today has almost nothing to do with climate. It is simply to do with human activity and human persecution. Trophic means pertaining to food or feeding. It's about eating or being eaten. So it's about food chains, it's about food webs. And the trophic levels, you've got your top carnivore, you've got your meso predators, your some medium-sized carnivores, you've got your big herbivores, you know, it goes all the way down. You know what a food chain looks like. Those are all the trophic layers in the food chain. And in this country, for instance, as I've just explained, we've lost most of our trophic layers, but most ecologists are unaware of the fact. They've managed to overlook the fact that actually the unaffected state of the ecosystem, unaffected by human beings, would have been an ecosystem dominated by a megafauna with elephants and rhinos. And as a result of that forgetfulness amongst professional ecologists, there's been this lack of awareness that the systems we've been studying are artificial systems. They do not reflect the state of nature. And when you look at systems which do retain many of their trophic layers, you begin to stumble across something which I believe is one of the most exciting findings in any branch of science of the past half century. And this is the discovery of widespread trophic cascades. Now, you know what trophic is? You know what a cascade is. A trophic cascade is an ecosystem process which starts not at the bottom of the ecosystem, but at the top of the food chain and tumbles all the way down to the bottom. The classic example of this, the one which is most often cited because it is a wonderful example, but there are now scores and scores, so many are accumulating that it's beginning to seem that trophic cascades are the default setting of the ecosystem, that this is how the ecosystem works when it's still got its trophic layers in place. But the classic example of this is what happened when wolves were reintroduced to the Yellowstone National Park in 1995. They'd been absent for 70 years after they'd been extirpated. It's a really interesting commentary on how our attitudes to nature have changed. That, you know, that a century ago in the Yellowstone National Park, the best practice was considered getting rid of all the predators and keeping the herbivores, the bison and the rest, in enclosures to protect them. So they killed the wolves and the pumas and the other predators, and coyotes and the rest of it, because they thought that was looking after nature. Not dissimilar to what conservationists do in this country, by the way. As I said, we'll be coming to that. And so they got rid of all the wolves, and then they had a massive population explosion of deer, as one would have, and that resisted attempts by human beings to control them effectively. The Yellowstone National Park is a huge area, and they simply, the rangers could not shoot enough deer to make a difference. And the result was that much of the park ended up like the Highlands of Scotland, or indeed like any of the sheep-wrecked wastelands of our, which is what we call our national parks in this country. Another thing I'll be coming on to, how Britain has been shanked by sheep. So you had this sort of developing moonscape in Yellowstone. And they introduced two small packs of wolves, just a very, very small number of wolves. Almost immediately, I mean literally within a couple of years, the entire ecology of the Yellowstone National Park began to change. It wasn't that the wolves were eating so many deer. I mean, they couldn't eat that many deer. There are so many deer there and there are so few wolves. But what the wolves did was to create what biologists call a landscape of fear. And a landscape of fear is a very interesting thing because it has ecological ramifications which go far beyond the trophic, far beyond the actual physical act of eating and being eaten. It means that there are places where prey animals no longer go. And in the case of deer, those are places where they can easily be cornered or caught. The river valleys and the gorges and the twists and the turns, the places where the wolves could trap them, they were just completely vacated by deer. And the regeneration was, I mean, people could scarcely believe what they were seeing. In some parts of the valleys, the height of the trees quintupled in just 6 years. And places which were basically more or less bare hillside reverted to forests of aspens and willows and cottonwoods within the blink of an eye. As they did so, those forests began to fill up with migratory birds, and the number of songbirds escalated to another extraordinary extent. Bison, their populations began to rise as well because they're browsing animals, which like to eat the shrubs. So did the number of bears, because they not only eat the berries on the shrubs, but they're also scavenging on the carcasses which the wolves left behind. And the bears then reinforce the impact of the wolves by eating some of the deer calves as their population increased. Beavers began to return to the rivers because, of course, beavers eat the shoots of the aspen and the willow and the cottonwood trees, and they started building their dams. Now, beavers, like wolves, are ecosystem engineers. They are what are called keystone species. A keystone species is a species which has an ecological impact way beyond what its biomass alone would suggest, its numbers alone would suggest. And the beavers created habitat for a whole range of species, for otters, for muskrats, for amphibians, for ducks, for fish, for invertebrates, and for reptiles. And they began to reinforce that remarkable restoration project which the wolves had begun. The number of bald eagles and ravens began to rise, again because they were scavenging on the carcasses that the wolves left behind. The number of hawks began to rise, and weasels and foxes and badgers, because the wolves were killing coyotes, which meant that the population of rodents was expanding. But here's where it gets really interesting. The behaviour of the rivers began to change. They stopped meandering so much, the channels narrowed, riffle sections and pools would start to form. And it's because the returning vegetation stabilised the banks. The hillsides, at the rate of erosion, fell significantly because, again, the returning vegetation stabilised the soil. The wolves transformed not only the entire ecosystem of the Yellowstone National Park, but also the physical geography. Two small packs of wolves. Whales in the Southern Ocean have similarly wide-ranging impacts. One of the many crap excuses used by the Japanese government for hunting whales was that if we get rid of the whales, there'll be far more fish and krill for human beings to eat, and won't that be a wonderful world? And you know, it seems intuitive, doesn't it? Obviously, whales eat phenomenal quantities of fish and krill, so you get rid of the whales, there are bound to be more fish and krill. But it's not what happened. The opposite happened. They got rid of a lot of the whales, and the fish and krill populations fell. How could this possibly be so? How could this be the case? It turns out that the whales, like the wolves, are critical for the functioning of the entire ecosystem. Sure, they kill things, but they give life to far more than they kill, and they have two particular impacts. One is that they often feed at depth, and then they come up to the surface and produce up there in the surface waters what biologists politely call large fecal plumes. Enormous outpourings of poo. Poonamis. and these, of course, are very rich in iron and the other nutrients which limit growth. And what they've done is to transport those nutrients up into the photic zone, the place where there's enough light for photosynthesis. And that, of course, allows the phytoplankton to reproduce, and that allows the zooplankton to reproduce, and that allows the fish and the krill and the rest of it to reproduce. And there's your entire ecosystem basically being sustained by the recycling of nutrients. And there are many, many examples like this around the world. The evidence at the ecosystem level supporting James Lovelock's Gaia hypothesis, which conceives of the world as a coherent, self-regulating system, is beginning to accumulate. An ecosystem missing its large species functions in a completely different way to an ecosystem which retains them. And they make, in my view, a powerful case for the introduction, the reintroduction of missing animals and plants. And this, to me, is one critically important component of what I've come here to talk about, which is rewilding. It's a question of taking down the fences, blocking up the drainage ditches, creating large areas at sea from which commercial activities are excluded, bringing back missing species, and then stepping back and leaving it alone. There's a question of, you know, abandoning that notion of biblical dominion, that the world depends on us, the world's been given to us to look after, we're the stewards and the guardians of it, and haven't we looked after it just so well? And that it depends on us to look after it, otherwise, you know, things will happen. Vermin will take over, and unwanted noxious species and all of this sort of stuff. And yeah, sure, you know, I recognise that there are certain exotic invasive species with which the natural system in countries in which they enter can't cope. And there are one or two which maybe will continue to need to be controlled by human beings. So I was going to say sheep, but actually wolves will do a pretty good job of sorting them out. But you know, there are a few. But actually, fewer than you might think. You look at the places where you would expect the natural world to be most vigorous, most ferocious in the United Kingdom. And of course, they're the places where there are fewest people and where there's less intensive agriculture. And I'm talking about the uplands. The uplands of Britain, where you can't, on the whole, do arable agriculture. The land's very poor, very infertile. In fact, you can't farm there by any means at all without enormous amounts of farm subsidies. When you look at the State of Nature report, which was published in 2011, it showed that there had been an overall decline in, what was it, 20 years or 50 years, I can't remember, 20 years, I think, a horrible decline of sort of 60% of the abundance of, 60% of the species it studied had a marked decline in abundance during that 20 years, as I think it was. In the uplands, it was 65%. The places where there are fewest people, where there's least intense agriculture, had actually done worse. And David Attenborough goes on the Today programme and said, oh, the problem is human population, which is, the answer is human population, what's the question, as far as most post-reproductive white men are concerned. Actually, it's absolutely not what the problem is. Yeah, I mean, that has an impact. But actually, the real impact is agriculture and the way we engage through agriculture with the land. And what has the biggest impact of all turns out not to be the intensive arable agriculture of the lowlands, it's the sheep farming in the uplands. And the sheep is a fantastically destructive species. It's an exotic from Mesopotamia, and our vegetation has very few defences against it, and it is extremely good at reducing an ecosystem to almost nothing, as you'll see in all the uplands of Britain. I mean, these would have been largely forested. In a few places there would have been a tree line, in most places there wouldn't have been. There would have been forest pretty well the whole way up, and a very rich and diverse ecosystem. Anywhere in the tropics, you talk to tropical ecologists, and I tell you, the rest of the world is so far ahead of the UK on this. And you say to them, why do floods happen? I say, well, that's obvious. Floods happen because there aren't any trees in the hills. You know, instead of the rain percolating down through the soil and then flowing gently down in a nice steady flow, it flashes off and you get flood and then drought and flood and then drought and flood and then drought. And you know, if you want to stop floods, you've got to do it in the catchment, you do it in the watershed. That's the place where it counts. You go to someone in Britain and you say, why do floods happen? They say, oh, it's building on the floodplain. There's all this stuff in the floodplain, mismanagement in the floodplain, drainage in the wrong places, canalisation. Sure, it all makes a contribution. But it's like, is that where rivers begin? Is that where it starts? We just completely ignore what's going on in the rest of the catchment. It's just not there as far as these people are concerned. And you go up there and you'll find, you know, yeah, wait a minute, there's no trees here. There's bare rock. In much of the Lake District, it's been reduced to bare rock. And the soil There's a friend of mine who works for an agency in Wales who has this demonstration he does. He takes it to the Royal Welsh Show and other places, show to sheep farmers. It's very interesting, the reactions he gets. Where he takes a soil core from a sheep farm in the hills, and he'll take a soil core from a piece of woodland in the hills. And they'll be in this nice clear cylinder, clear plastic cylinder, and then they take a few litres of water and they pour the litre into both. And it is a most remarkable thing, because in the woodlands, it just, you can see it just bubbling through, you know, and there are all sort of air bubbles coming out, and it sort of filters through from the sheep pasture. It just sits there. It doesn't do anything. You might as well pour it onto concrete. It's just, it's quite amazing, because the sheep, they're small, sharp hooves. They can pack the soil so effectively. And so, you know, you see all these horrendous examples of houses being washed away, and people drowned in some cases, and millions of carpets ruined, and all the rest of it. And no one's making the connection. It's the sodding sheep which are doing it. Pointing out that there is actually a problem here. There's a problem which people just do not want to hear about. But, you know, the standard response I get is, well, what about food production then? You know, you want to take some of this land out of production, people are going to starve. So obviously I looked into this, and I found out, taking Wales as my case study, because Wales, you know, the sheep, you know, there's 8 million sheep in Wales, outnumber people almost 3 to 1, and it turns out that 76% of Wales, that's just over 3/4 of Wales, is under livestock production, and almost all of that is for meat. There's very little non-meat production there, and the wool is worth almost nothing to mountain sheep. There's very little dairy activity, very little egg production. It's almost all for meat. And yet Wales, by value, imports 7 times as much meat as it exports. Isn't that the most extraordinary thing? You devote 3/4 of your land area to producing the sodding stuff, and you import 7 times as much by value as you're exporting. But it's worse than those stark figures suggest, because every year the flooding caused by the sheep takes out thousands of hectares of prime agricultural arable land in the downstream areas of the rivers. You take the Severn and the Wye, for instance, they both drain off Pimlimmon in the middle of the Cambrian Desert, and most years large areas of the lower reaches of farms around the lower reaches of the Severn and the Wye are taken out of production. This is some of the best farmland in Britain, and it's so good that most of it is horticultural. You know, it's fantastic land. And if you subtract the lost production as a result of that, and as a result of the reduction of irrigation water because of that cycle of flood and drought, you are likely to find, so I've got people seeing if they can actually do the stats at the moment, there's a lot of difficulties and variables involved, but you're likely to find, because production in the hills is so low, that hill farming actually produces a net loss of food. My approach to this is to say, I don't want to get rid of the farmers, I want to get rid of a lot of the sheep, that's for sure. But what I want to do is to give farmers a choice they currently don't possess, because there's this extraordinary situation where if you want to take the major component of your farm subsidy, that through roundabout means all of your farm subsidy, the single farm payment, you have to keep the land bare. In the rules, it says that you have to remove what it calls unwanted vegetation. The rest of us call it wildlife habitat. You have to remove unwanted vegetation if you're to receive your money. And so all over Europe, that single rule, buried in the Good Agricultural and Environmental Conditions, Rule 12, buried right down at the bottom of these layers and layers of bureaucracy, that single rule has caused this orgy of habitat destruction since it was introduced in 2004. So what I'm saying is, take that rule away. Have a cap on the maximum amount that any farmer can get. You know, I don't think anyone should be paid for having more than 100 hectares of land. You know, at the moment you're paid by the hectare, so the more land you have, the more you're paid, which puts small farmers at a disadvantage. Cap that, and then take away that rule, and then let the farmers do what they want. And the farmers who have got a strong cultural commitment to sheep farming and to their traditions and to their ancestors and the rest of it, they'll keep going. And they'll take the hit. It's a hit. You know, I mean, at the moment in Wales, the average subsidy for a hill farm in Wales is £53,000. Mm. The average income at the end of the year is £33,000. You lose £20,000 a year by keeping sodding sheep in the hills. So you're going to have... But the farmers who want to carry on doing that, they can carry on doing that. There's nothing to stop them. But the absentee ranchers who control an increasing amount of the land and got no cultural commitment to it at all, no interest in anything, basically, but reaping the subsidies, will quickly discover that chasing sheep around rain-sodden hills is a less lucrative option than lying on the beach. And lying on the beach is what we want them to do, because that then allows the land to start to recover. And what I want to see happen is that land then starts to be reforested and we start to introduce back into it some of the species which we are missing. There's one estimate which suggests that between 2000 and 2030, even if the current subsidy regime remains in place, an area of land on the continent of Europe of 30 million hectares will be vacated by farmers. And this is despite the best efforts of their governments, which are desperately trying to keep farmers on the land, but short of maintaining them there in corrals at gunpoint, they are unable to do so because the young people don't want to stay on the land. And in a global food market, the unproductive land becomes uncompetitive. If we claim to love nature, why not love all of nature? Why not look at the whole trophic system, the whole trophic structure, and think about bringing that back? And this takes me, I suppose, onto a second definition of rewilding that fascinates me, which is the rewilding of our own lives. And I'm not talking here about giving up our houses, giving up our jobs, giving up our iPads and iPods and all the other things that we claim to enjoy. But I'm talking about having places in which self-willed nature is allowed to develop under its own steam, through which we may freely roam. Places in which we can escape the ordered, regulated, manicured, buttoned-down, comfortable, cushioned existence which we're forced into for the rest of our lives. Places in which we can experience the incomparable thrill of wild nature in its raw and untrammeled and unmediated state, both on sea and at land. And in my experience so far of going to places where that is the case in Europe and of trying to find pockets of it, mostly at sea in the United Kingdom, it's an experience qualitatively different to a visit to any other part of the countryside. It's something which is enthralling, engaging. It involves you in ecstasy in the true sense. It takes you out of the state of being in which we normally reside. And it begins, from my point of view at any rate, to reignite some of those buried fires, that parts of that ghost psyche, which I believe we neglect at the cost of the loss of much of what makes life rich and wonderful and enchanting. Rewilding, it gives us that positive environmentalism which says, here is not just a less bad world than it would otherwise have been, which is a basic task of environmental campaigning, but a much better world than it is. What it brings to us is something which has been missing from our lives to an even greater degree than those have, which is hope. And an ounce of hope is worth a ton of despair. If you're trying to encourage people to love and engage with and care for the natural world, actually what you need to give them is hope. And that's what's been missing. That's what we haven't been able to give people. All we've been able to give people is a story of despair, and that only takes you so far. What rewilding offers us is a story that ecological change does not all have to proceed in the same direction, that it's not all downhill. A story rewilding tells is that our silent spring could be followed by a raucous summer. Thank you.